Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Neon Rabbitt podcast. Here I am, JB, with my good friend, DC.
What's up, everybody?
How's it going, Jeremy?
I'm doing fabulous.
So, hey, we got another fantastic, amazing show lined up for you.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so we have some recaps of some stories we've been doing. We've been trying to follow pretty closely, so why don't you take that away, Jeremy?
Absolutely. If you remember on our first and, I believe, our third episode, we started talking about the incident where the young man, Adam Johnson, I believe his name was, was accidentally killed by Matt Petgrave on the ice during a hockey game with his skate.
To the throat.
Yeah, right to the throat. And it was a horrible tragedy. And once again, we express our condolences to the deceased. Now, it seems that everybody is getting up in arms about this thing. And we're going to put neck guards on our youth. Now, some people think that this is going to be silly. It's going to look weird. But you know what? There's a father out there who said, as long as everybody's doing it, nobody's going to care what it looks like. And I agree with that.
That's true. And these are like kind of what I was talking about, like real world consequences anyways for what happened here at this game. But to come to find out, and it's not necessarily surprising, but like other people have been injured in similar ways with skate. So yeah, hey, neck guards. I'm all for it.
Yeah.
Especially at the, you know, this article or whatever we were going on was particularly talking about kids, and like especially in like youth leagues, like why not just the more protection the better.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, it's something that should have been implemented years ago, regardless of how you look or how it might feel. I mean, you are exposed to blades out there, essentially. So, yeah, neck guard up, as they would say. So, yeah, that's the first recap we wanted to do. Another recap we wanted to talk about, as we said we would follow up on, is the death of beloved Matthew Perry, Chandler Bing from Friends. And it does turn out, unfortunately, and I wished against this one, guys, Matthew Perry did, in fact, die of an acute amount of Special K, a.k.a. ketamine. He did not die clean. It's sad, but it's true.
Yeah.
In his hot tub. It's a vicious circle addiction. It's something that really you need help with a lot. And he tried. He really did. It's a very sad thing when these things happen, especially to people who have become so ingrained in our culture and endeared by generation after generation. So
No, is it just me, or does this seem to be like a trend though in that world? Let's say like the Hollywood world, especially like comedians.
Oh,
it
yeah.
used to be rock stars who were all like drugs and alcohol all the time, and now it's like every comedian you hear pretty much, you know, has like this huge history with substance abuse.
Yeah, I'm not sure what triggers it out there, but it's available.
I assume it's those personalities too, you know, like those guys have wild personalities, and like genius normally comes with some quirks to it too.
You're absolutely right. Yeah, it's just that kind of mind that those things attract.
Yeah, I mean, because I got to think about Chris Farley, right?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Way before his time, that dude was great. Tommy Boy, Black Sheep. Hell, even Beverly Hills Ninja, I got a chuckle out of. And everybody knows that was a farce from script.
It was a good movie, dude. I don't think I'd ever seen anything with Chris Farley in it that I didn't like.
Yeah.
And, like, his story's sad. Like he's a super funny guy, but you know, inside he doesn't feel funny. He doesn't feel like people like him, and that's,
I think, the saddest aspect of his death was that David Spade didn't go to his funeral.
He didn't go?
No, he didn't. I forgot the reason why. I think it might have been too much for him or something like
that. I can imagine.
It's sad because they were good friends.
If you hear some of David Spade's stories though, it's like they would get in like fights, and Chris was kind of a crazy dude.
Oh yeah, I mean his on-screen personality was on par with his regular personality,
right? And
sure.
Then when it came to the drugs, like Dave's got some crazy stories of Chris doing some wild things on drugs too. So
yeah, his rider was coke, wasn't it? He was a big cocaine head.
It's in my head like Speedball was a thing that
I don't
even know what that is, but yeah.
I'm assuming, because I don't know, because I don't take that stuff. But, yeah, I'm assuming it's some kind of a upper.
Yeah, yeah.
Comment
yeah.
below if I'm wrong, please.
Well, anyways, still, you know, rest in peace. Rest in peace, Mr. Matthew Perry, regardless of the circumstances of your death.
Yeah, yeah. And speaking of drugs, I'm ashamed of you, Miss Liv Morgan.
Tisk, tisk.
No, I'm not, because I smoke weed, too. Liv Morgan just got arrested on Thursday with possession of, I believe, a small amount of marijuana in a, it actually said that a fuzzy pink bag, as well as a vape with oil that tested positive for THC. I think it said that she went a little over the line somewhere down in Florida. I think it's Sumter, Florida. And she got pulled over, and she got busted with some THC.
Liv Morgan, WWE superstar, by the way, female wrestler.
Yeah. She's been on the injured list for a while. She's still on the roster. But if Matt Riddle is anything to go by in this kind of a situation, we may be seeing some serious repercussions from this.
Seems like you can start off with a warning before, like, you know, you have to think about firing somebody from their job for something like this. I still think it's a shame that the WWE does this. The Matt Riddle thing was a shame. I wish that they did not do that. And, yeah, their wellness policy in regards to this substance is kind of silly.
Yeah, especially with what marijuana has become today. It's not the end-all, be-all of a hippie generation anymore. It's not as dangerous as heroin or crack. You know, we've embraced the fact that it is actually quite beneficial, quite medicinal in its own right.
Right.
And I think that some of the archaic ways that they treat their superstars are just like they're people. And they go through a lot. And a lot of the chemicals in painkillers and pills, give me a natural herb that comes from the planet any day over a pill.
Well, right. Yeah. And I mean, if you know anything about like WWE superstar histories, like substance abuse, there's another like group of guys that substance abuse runs heavy with. Mm-hmm. And to think like, yeah, there's a whole number of things, nearly like any kind of recreational drug you can think of, like, would be worse for their health, more advantageous than this one. But
mm-hmm.
They stick them pretty hard for these things.
They do. They do. They really do. And I don't know what the outcome's going to be. I hope that she stays with the WWE. I like Liv Morgan. I think she's a pretty decent wrestler.
Mm-hmm.
As far as the WWE goes, I haven't been keeping up on it lately, so I have no idea what's going on lately. But, yeah, we'll see what happens. But there's another wrestler that I want to talk about, JB.
Oh, dude. Even the concept of us, like, coming. So let's just break it. Mr. Hulk Hollywood Hogan, okay? We were talking, like, Mount Rushmore of wrestlers the other day, and, like, for me, I was going like the characters that I like, and mm-hmm. I don't know that Hulk Hogan registers on that, but if it was like for, you know, who did the most for the WWE, like Hulk Hogan's up there for wrestling in general,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
Hulk Hogan's definitely one of them, and I just got a wild hair to start. Why was he Hollywood Hogan, you know? Let's go back and revisit his Hollywood experience, because now, like, John Cena's hitting the scene, and we got The Rock. It's not unheard of for these wrestlers to be celebrities.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, in film. And Hulk Hogan's really the one who started it. So I wanted to watch, because I had a fond memory from my childhood, the movie Suburban Commando.
Yeah, you did.
Oh, yeah. And I messaged you, hey, I'm getting ready to look for Suburban Commando. I want to watch that.
Yeah.
And Jeremy sends me a link, and he's like, here's the link on YouTube.
Yep.
You know how I know? Because I watched it last week. It was like,
great minds think alike.
So yeah, on top, I'll do the same lead in here. So mm-hmm. I was challenged, basically, or I said that I would watch the Snyder cut of the Justice League movie. So I did that the same day, mm-hmm. and I enjoyed that. Just to get my opinion out on the that was a much better film there. Was it just in black and white, or was it just the version that I watched?
The one you watched was probably in black and white. They do have a regular colored version.
Okay.
But yeah, I don't know why they pushed the black and white version.
I wasn't into that. And like that, without that, it could have probably had my attention more. And it was a good movie, but I kind of I was fading in and out of attention in that movie.
Yeah.
Okay. But then I put on Suburban Commando, right? And I was glued to the screen for the entire time. I can't, it's silly. It's my nostalgic heart. I'm sure somebody else has a different opinion, but I loved every minute of this movie, okay? So, Jeremy, what is it? Give us the lead in. What's this movie about?
This movie is simply about a, I don't know what would you, I guess you, a commando?
He's a space commando.
Yeah, he's a space commando.
In the terms of, like, your commando, he's the lone wolf. He goes in on his own, you know, and yeah, he's the top dog. He takes care of business by himself.
And so the movie basically starts out with a Star Wars. I have notes. I have a lot of notes on this, and I'm just going to go through these notes one by one and just kind of, you know, explain what these notes are, because they are just kind of a little bit wishy-washy. But the first line is Star Wars ripoff opening blatant.
Total.
Total blatant ripoff of the Star Wars opening. Ship, lasers. I mean, you could put behind that that image, and it would fit perfectly.
Shameless, but hey, for the time, like, that was the way to do that. So I shame them not.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Next one, Ramsey, way too much skin showing for that to protect him.
Hey. It's space equipment, dude. You don't know what to do.
Yeah, but I mean, honestly, I mean, you saw how much skin was showing between those armor plates.
That outfit cost him like a million space bucks.
Oh, millions. Okay, next note. Razor letter. That's the scene where Hulk Hogan goes to help the president, who is being held hostage by a man named General Suter. And the president, who has Suter distracted, somehow reaches into his cuff of his coat and produces what appears to be a regular letter, but apparently it can be thrown like a throwing knife and cuts off General Suter's hand, which in turn reveals that General Suter is in fact some sort of reptilian monster.
That didn't do it because it was a human hand. He had a reptile hand.
Yeah, he had a reptilian hand coming out of a stump. Negotiations have ended!
It's like the Hulk. That's what's happening. That's kind of funny. Hulk Hogan fighting Hulk in a way. Okay,
yeah,
Space Hulk.
He's Space Hulk, hulking out. And the next line I have is Ramsey leaves president for dead. Because that's exactly what he does. We don't see the president die. We see General Suter kind of grab onto him and like make him pass out. Instead of trying to save the president, Ramsey just 86s out of the ship and leaves behind explosives as he's falling down this shaft.
And I'm like, it was too late for the president.
Yeah, I was like, the president? The president?
Sorry, Mr. President.
The president.
Hey, any good president would be like, I'm going down with the ship, son. You know?
I guess that's what his thoughts were. So from there, I have, let me see. He blows up the ship. Oh, stabilize me. Stabilize me. Hitting the button, stabilizing. He can't get stabilized in his own freaking pod, so he keeps hitting the same button over and over. And finally, he gets stabilized. He gets brought back to his ship. My next note is, what is galactic narc duty? I want to know. Because he goes to his ship, and he wants to find his next mission. So he talks to his commanding officer. He's like, you got to have something on your books. How about a terrorist extermination?
No.
Galactic narc duty.
Which is right.
What is galactic narc duty?
It's probably like he's doing like drug...
Intergalactic DEA, basically.
Yeah, he's undercover.
Okay. And then how about a giant bug hunt with creatures that bleed acid? It's like,
no.
No, hell yeah, dude. That's exactly where you send.
Oh, that's where you would send it, but apparently it's just not happening in outer space.
Ramses? Was that his whole name, Ramses?
It was Shep Ramsey.
Shep Ramsey.
Not Chef Ramsey, but Shep Ramsey.
Shep. I did keep in hearing Shep.
Shep Ramsey.
Chef Gordon Ramsay.
Yeah. Fucking donkey. Anyway, my next note is he breaks his own ship because he's throwing a hissy fit, which basically what he does. The guy tells him to take a break, take a vacation because, you know, you've done everything you can in this system. So Shep gets all pissy and breaks his own ship. So the guy's like, well, you got to go somewhere to recharge your ship. Well, where am I going to go? You're going to go to Earth.
No, I hate Earthlings. I hate Earthlings.
Yeah.
We are pretty unsufferable, you know.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. We are. I mean, come on. I mean, this note I have here is going to prove it. Because he lands on Earth. Well, he doesn't land. He kind of crash lands into an old school roller discotheque. And for some reason, he turns the lights on to reveal that it is, in fact, a discotheque. There's disco music playing. There's disco lights. And this just further fuels his rage against us Earthlings because we apparently had a thing for disco in the 70s that he doesn't like.
A quick aside, we need to bring back skate rinks.
Okay. Continue. Oh, absolutely. Dude, skating rinks?
It was a pinnacle part of like my childhood, and we should bring it back. Anyways, go ahead, dude.
So then we get our opening titles where we get the Suburban Commando burp rap.
Just good old 90s music.
Oh, yeah. Hulk is actually getting in on it. He's like, it's a nice place to live. And Hulk,
he was a bass player, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, he was involved in a band before he was a wrestler. Yeah, he was a bass player. So now we're introduced to probably the greatest character in the film besides Hulk. My man, Christopher Lloyd. Mm-hmm. I love Christopher Lloyd. I don't know how you feel about him, JB. Do you like Christopher Lloyd?
I mean, generally, he's just a good actor, right?
Like, I love Christopher Lloyd. I don't see him in much, but I really do enjoy his acting. It's his voice. It's Doc. I mean, it's classic. But we get introduced to Christopher Lloyd's character, Charlie, welding a skateboard. And when his daughter comes in, you realize what a 90s movie this is. Because I believe she uses the term, God, Dad, get a grip. It's totally blah, blah. And I wrote down, it's totally 1991. And Hulk is rapping while this is all going on. So Charlie goes to his kitchen to meet and greet his family. And we're introduced to Shelley Duvall.
Uh-huh.
Do you have anything to say about Shelley Duvall?
She's very, is the word emasculating? That's kind of the whole character of, you know, the other guy here. He's an emasculated, weak male.
Yeah, you got to ask for that raise, Charlie. You got to ask for that raise. Meanwhile, she's like, what, 80 pounds soaking wet?
Oh, yeah. So, again, though, fantastic cast here, right? Big names.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, shit, Shelley Duvall. I mean, she was in one of my favorite movies of all time, The Shining.
Can we say, how well did this movie do? How was it received in its time? I remember it when I was a child.
I want to say it was released in theaters, but I don't think it did very well. I should look it up. You want me to look it? I'll look up the box office for Suburban Commando.
Okay, because again, like just a pretty well put together cast of like some decent names, recognizable in Hollywood. We'll come up with they have another WWE wrestler cameo, and Hulk Hogan. I don't. It's funny to think this is. In my mind, and I don't know the timeline, but in my mind, this is like Hulk Hogan's first movie. It's probably not.
The first movie I remember him in was one called, I think it was called No Holds Barred.
Okay, yes, that's definitely, I believe that's definitely one of his movies.
And that has Tiny Lister, or Zeus. The
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, the guy who had the Z shaved in his
head.
They
turned him in, he ended up being like in the wrestling show.
Yeah, he was WrestleMania 5 or
yeah, they made
remember.
Him like a real character.
Suburban Commando grossed $8 million in the U.S.
Well, again, though, like those people in it, you'd think that it was a even in just casting, it was a costly movie.
Oh yeah, you got Christopher Lloyd, Shelley Duvall, Hulk Hogan, and then even on the side cast, you have Larry Miller, who was a well-known comedian at the time, who plays his boss.
Right.
And I don't. Who else is in that movie that we know? I don't think anybody.
Well, the ruin the cameo upcoming, but Mark Calloway.
Mark Calloway was I wanted was that before he was the Undertaker?
No, I don't. No? I don't think there's any way it was, but maybe because I know like in wrestling history, like Hulk Hogan was shunned basically mm-hmm. for having went and done movies. Like that's I think that's kind of like what initiated his. Departure from the WWE to WCW.
Yeah, you're right. They didn't want him doing movies.
So it's strange that Mark Calloway, aka The Undertaker, would make a cameo in this movie, and that they would be okay with that.
Yeah, in the best way too. Let's face it. He's got the best mean mug.
It's weird because I really love watching these guys, and I agree. Like for the role that he played here. Which we'll get to, right?
Yeah.
He was wonderful. And one of my favorite movies, and it's the same concept of why I loved it, Princess Bride. Okay. Andre the Giant's...
I love Andre in that movie.
What was his character? I forget his
He's
name.
He's Fezzing.
There
Fezzi,
you go.
The big guy. Fezzi.
He was so amazing in that role. Like, I don't care what anybody says. That movie's awesome, and if only for Andre, that movie is fantastic.
Yeah.
Yeah, I do love Andre in that movie. I wish I could remember any of his one-liners. That whole poem he did.
Anybody want a peanut? I remember that.
Anybody want a peanut?
I don't think that word means what you think it means. But there's an incredibly impressive human being anyways, though. Like, I would have really, really enjoyed having... Like, there's, like, if you could go back in time and meet, like, somebody, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, half the time my answer is Andre the Giant. Like, I would just like to meet him, see him, hear some of his stories. But
oh, yeah, just to talk to him would be great. All right, so getting back to Suburban Commando, my next note is go get him, Charlie. And I remember Charlie is practicing his request for a raise to the secretary waiting outside of the boss's office, played by Larry Miller, who, as I wrote, is a douchebag.
He's a douchebag. He's the kind of boss who puts his name on your work and takes credit for what you've done. So it's depicted that Charlie definitely deserves a raise.
Oh, yeah, definitely. He's done a lot of work, he spent the whole weekend on the plans, and Larry's like, do you know I spend the whole weekend with a blonde?
Huh? But let's face it, right? He's a beta, right?
Oh,
beta male.
Total beta.
So he doesn't get his raise, right? Because he's a beta. No. He is a pushover.
Oh, yeah, totally.
Until in walks his life fucking... Excuse me. Super alpha.
Super alpha, brother.
And,
sorry.
My next note is, what a dick. Just under Larry Miller's character. A dick.
Let's see. That's the crux of his character, though. Is
yeah.
That he's
oh,
just,
oh, yeah.
He's a dick.
He's just a dick boss. My next note is Ford Festiva. This movie has a Ford Festiva in it. It is totally 1991.
And I love it. I'm there for every minute of it, dude.
Yep. That whole scene where it's like, how does that, you really have to explain this to me, because I watched that scene 1,000 times and I have any idea how it works. They all line up to the line. The light goes green.
Oh, they're like racing?
Racing to get to, the light turns red and he won't even go, like he's too afraid to go with the rest.
I think
I don't understand that.
That's more of like a depiction of his beta-ness, okay.
Like, more examples of him being a
beta. He's afraid to push it.
Oh,
you know?
My God. Okay. All right. That makes sense. Yeah. Okay. So my next note is that codpiece has to chafe. This is the scene where Hulk Hogan is walking down the street.
In that baller armor.
Dude, total baller armor.
I still don't know what that means, but it's cool.
I'll hip you to the slang of the 2Ks.
Anyways, baller out armor.
Next note is Indian dude freaks out on Hulk. What the hell are you? What the hell are you doing, huh? Hulk is simply walking down the street. Granted, he is dressed like he's cosplaying for Star Wars, but he's just walking down the street, and this Indian guy is like full on with the broom. What the hell are you doing? Who are you?
That's exactly how I see it, though, if that would have happened in real life in the 90s. But today, people would just be like, cool digs, bro.
Like, oh, yeah. It was like, where's the camera? He's live streaming something. Okay, so the next one, Hulk always wants to help, and this is the soda machine. The next scene is a soda machine will not give this lady her money back, and Hulk has to make it right, and he knows exactly what to do. Violence.
Yeah.
Solves everything.
Bam, bam.
It really does.
There you go, ma'am.
Okay, now we have Shut Up, Ralph. Okay, so this is the scene where Hulk Hogan is, again, walking down the street, just kind of trying to figure out how to get what he needs to get. And a poor little doggy is just trapped behind a window of a car. And he's got a muzzle on, and he's just barking, yapping away. And Hulk's like, oh, poor little doggy. Where's your owner? And the owner is like a total white trash, big beer belly, long hair, beard. And for some reason, this guy is eating at a place that looks way too fancy for him. I'm sorry, I'll say that. And he's like, shut up, Ralph! Shut up, Ralph!
Apparently, he's just a dick to his dog. You can't do that.
Yeah, and Hulk is like, comes over to... Dude, this guy is huge. It's Hulk fucking Hogan.
He's a big man.
And this dude's like, yeah, what do you want? What did you expect was going to happen next?
Yeah.
So, exactly. Hulk puts him in the truck somehow. Puts a muzzle on him. Hulk is committing crimes.
That's what I was like. It's like he's a good guy, right? But he just like beats the crap out of a dude for being kind of mean to his dog.
Yeah.
Like, it seems like somebody's committing assault while somebody was just being a dick. Like,
yeah, exactly. And he steals his clothes. Somehow they fit. Somehow.
Terminator. This is, yeah.
Yeah, Terminator logic. So my next note is apartment for rent. That way. No other directions. No address. Just an apartment for rent and an arrow pointing that way.
It's the 90s, dude. Like, no, people didn't have GPS and stuff anyway. It's like, that's all you need is like a landmark. See, when you three white houses down, take a left.
Yeah, this was an arrow pointing in a very busy street surrounded by a bunch of houses and cars. So however Hulk found it, I give him kudos. So next is dick neighbors blocking the driveway.
Mm-hmm.
Here's another example of Charlie's beta-ness at its finest. Charlie has these neighbors who, I guess they're drag racers.
They have drag cars, yeah.
Yeah. And like dick neighbors do, they park these cars in a manner where Charlie can't even get his Ford Festiva in the driveway.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not much to ask. The Ford Festiva's like this big. So, of course, the guy's like, hey, park across the street. You might, basically saying, hey, shut the fuck. Put your pussy mobile across
right.
the street.
Just like we men do to weaker men, you
exactly.
know.
Exactly. So, of course, Charlie submits. He does it. And he's just fuming at this point. So he gets into the house, and this is where.
Right, she pulls the rug from out underneath of him.
Shelley tries to be sexy, and
oh.
and this is where the nostalgia critic did a review of this movie, and he says that this should be a sexless marriage, and I 100% agree with them because Shelley Duvall trying to be sexy, it does not work. She had to put on a Cher wig, and she. She always wears these outfits that I don't know what I only judging by her face, I'm assuming she weighs like 70 pounds, 80 pounds. But you can never tell because she always wears these really billowy, huge outfits. Now, my wife says that's to mask a cocaine addiction. Mm. We don't know. But hey, getting back to Hollywood addiction, there right. it is. I don't know 100%, but yeah, Shelley Duvall trying to be sexy does not work. Christopher Lloyd flat out rejects her. Don't take this the wrong way, but I'm not in the mood. I just want to go to my workshop, take my hammer, and hit things. He says it just like that, like total docking out, right? So he goes to his workshop, and in one day, while he's at work, Shelley Duvall transforms his workshop into an apartment with TV lighting.
Because apparently they need money because it's an apartment. They're going to put it up for rent. Apparently they need money. That's why he needed to ask for the raise because they
you.
Actually needed the extra income.
I glanced past that completely. I'm sorry. Yes, you're right. They need the money. So she rented out the apartment or turned his workshop into an apartment. His tools are still there, though, right?
Yeah.
All behind the closet and shit. So we sit down to dinner.
She should actually, if they need extra money, she should probably get a job as an interior designer because she did that. That pretty quick.
I will say it was impressive how in one day it went from a workshop to a livable apartment with TV lighting. So my next note is, where were we? Dick teenager almost kills Charlie, which probably should have been before the whole apartment thing because once again, Charlie's a beta. So I guess I'm backtracking a little bit here. Charlie almost gets killed by the dick neighbor. Another dick neighbor who has a Camaro, I think.
Oh yeah, he speeds down the road all the time. That's that guy. Like if you live in a neighborhood, you probably have some car that drives mm-hmm. by every day, going too fast or something. That's this guy, right?
Yeah, that's this guy. I apologize. We have to backtrack a little bit. This is where we also meet the Colonel, who tells Charlie to grow some balls.
Oh yeah. What is this? Like a homeless guy who just.
He's a colonel. He's just a
but
retired
he's just, like,
colonel.
Sitting out in the front of the yard.
Yeah, sitting
all
out
day.
in his army jeep that they let him keep, and he's just getting wasted all day in his flak jacket and his meat helmet.
Sounds like a pretty good deal.
Yeah, exactly. So now that we're all caught up, oh yeah. So Shelley Duvall decides to rent this apartment to Shep Ramsey, who pretty much. Just,
who else?
Who comes to the door and is just.
I'm here to rent the apartment.
That's how these things work.
Yeah.
I'm here. Take my money.
Yeah.
Well, that's the thing. What money does he have? How is he paying for this?
Space bucks, dude.
Space bucks. Okay, space bucks. Okay,
yeah.
Well, that's better than what I thought.
I imagine it's like Doctor Who. Doctor Who has this thing, right? It's like a badge. And it, when he shows it to you, it's like it psychically makes you see it like as whatever is whatever he wants it to be. So okay. it's space bucks. It like is psychically whatever money you have.
Well, that is much better than what I thought. I thought him and Shelly had something worked out, if you know what I mean.
Oh, maybe. Well, that makes sense too.
I don't know. I mean, she ain't getting it from Charlie. So
And it's his fault, right?
He's the beta. He's totally the beta, and he's the one who rejected sex. Have you ever rejected sex? I mean, as a flat-out offer, I never have.
Yeah, it hasn't come
up. I'm talking from my wife only. Only from my wife. I don't do that. I don't do that messing around shit.
Nope.
So yeah, no money. How's he gonna pay? And my next note is these yours, and that's when Hulk is holding up Charlie's kids up. Yeah, just holding him in the air. And Shelly kind of freaks out. Now, this is another thing I was confused about. They have dinner with their tenant. I don't know too many landlords that do that.
I think in this situation, it kind of makes sense, though, because they're really just renting out, like, a room.
It's
not like he has facilities and things.
Okay,
so they're probably sharing those common areas.
Okay, so basically they will be sharing meals together. Like on a daily?
I mean, that would make sense to me. It's not a situation that I would want, but yeah.
No. Okay, so the next is he's from France. He's from France. When Shelly asks him where he's from,
I'm from France.
Can we talk about the kids real quick, too? Because when I was little, I could have sworn they were a bigger part of the movie, but they really just have those couple scenes.
Yeah.
And then they're kind of like forgotten about.
Yeah, you don't see much of the kids. I thought there was a little more involvement with the kids, like with Shep. There's a little scene with the younger boy when he saves his life later. We'll get to that. But nothing with the daughter at all. I don't think they even interact.
Just
that weird.
Yeah, yeah. I remembered it differently, but yeah. It was a long time ago, honestly, last time I watched this movie.
Yeah. No, it wasn't. We just watched it recently. Well,
touché.
Yeah, we watched it for the review this time. Okay, so my next note is Charlie finally grows some balls and go through Shep shit, blows up a car with a pew-pew felony, question mark?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he digs through his gadgets.
Yeah.
Because, of course, what's Hulk going to do? He's going to whip out all his guns and stick them under the mattress.
Yeah, of course, of course.
where guns go.
Yeah. And Charlie just got a little, I mean, he acted like he didn't know what a gun was. So he fired it, and he blew a hole through the wall, through the neighbor's car, which that's never addressed, is it?
God bless the movies where, like, you know, you can cause catastrophic damage and never have to answer for the, you know, consequences.
Exactly. It's weird. It just blew up, and how they freak out about their cars. You figure something would be addressed. My next note is the fucking Undertaker. This is where we start seeing the bounty hunters that are going to be coming after Shep. And one of them, as JB had mentioned, is the Undertaker, Mark Calloway, with the best mean mug in cinema history,
if you
ask me.
It's true. And hey, how many movies have you ever seen him appear in? Like, this is one of the very few that I know of.
I don't know of any other movie of Mark Calloway being in.
Right. So this might be like your only, because I mean, he is an aside here, but he's notorious for not breaking character once he was the Undertaker. And we were discussing like whether this was before or after he became the Undertaker, and truly we don't know. But yeah, this would be really odd for him to have done as the Undertaker with the reputation that he has. So, but yeah, I've never seen him in another movie. So.
Yeah, me neither.
It might be your only chance to ever see the Undertaker perform in a movie. So
right. So these are the two bounty. I don't know the other guy. I've seen him in a couple of films, but I don't know who his name is. Or what his name is.
Who his name is. I know who it should have been.
Please.
Mick Foley. It should have been Mick Foley. The Keeping the Wrestler theme.
Brilliant.
I think that would have been really cool. But anyways.
That's brilliant. Okay, so my next note is Charlie has major anxiety issues. So the next scene is Charlie. He's shaving himself, and he's also talking to himself fervently. He's just like, okay, I got to tell him he can't stay here. Darth Vader's in my tool shed. I got to get him out. I got to explain to him, Darth, you're not welcome here. You have to leave. So he finally gets the balls up enough of himself to go talk to him. And, of course, Shep is sitting in a lawn chair pumping iron, literally pumping iron and a drill press.
Yeah, yeah, he has tools, like a drill, two parts of a drill press.
Yeah.
He's shoulder pressing them.
And he's just going... So, of course, Christopher Lloyd once again betas out and is just like, oh, I'll talk to you later. And he takes off. And that's when we hear a scream come from inside the house.
Right.
And Shep being Shep.
The hero.
Yeah, the hero. He gets really up. Is. And he goes in the house to find Shelley Duvall screaming on the couch. So he grabs her, pulls her behind the couch. And this is where we find out that Shelley Duvall is screaming for help because of a talk show that she's watching. And I don't remember the exact word as she said, but I think she says, screaming out all your internal tensions before it becomes mental stress. And I don't know about you guys, but that sounds like you took two sentences out of a Cosmo and put them together. It just sounded really weird to me. Yeah. But so they start watching this show, and then Shep sees a hand come through the mail slot. Now, everybody here knows it's the mailman, right? Mm-hmm. But Shep doesn't know that, so he grabs a knife about, I don't know, about that long, would you say? A giant Bowie, butcher, whatever. And he goes to murder the mailman. Shelley Duvall has to stop him, of course. And the guy tells him to, you know, cut Hulk's caffeine because obviously he's had way too much.
Again, attempted murder, and it's just like, hey, man.
Yeah, just
don't do that again.
Yeah, hey, hey, guy. Hey. Yeah, so Shelley Duvall's finally had enough of it, and she's like, I'm going to go inside now. I can't deal with this. And we also get the paper boy who nails Shep in the chest with the paper. So Shep has to annihilate the kid with a newspaper by throwing it back. And he says, bullseye, smartass.
Everything that Hulk Hogan says in this movie is like a ridiculous one-liner. Like,
oh, yes. I mean, worse than Schwarzenegger, Stallone, absolutely. And Van Damme combined.
Like, every one of them stands on it on its own. Like, you know exactly what he means, and it works perfectly. And, again, I love it. I love all the one-liners.
Oh, yeah. So our next scene is some kids show up with a skateboard, and it turns out Ramsey can't board, bruh. That was my note.
No, he can't.
And he goes tits up. I mean, his legs go up, and he lands right on his back. And the kids, of course, they're being kids. They laugh, and Shep can't take the laughter of children, so he throws that board. I put, quote, stupid far.
Of course he did.
He just through the sky.
He's an alpha. His ego's like ginormous. That's the one thing on this guy that you can hurt.
Yep. So we get an introduction from Shep to the colonel. And the colonel, he gives his rank and stuff and blah, blah, blah. So Shep, in kind, gives his rank. So they kind of bond over their military background, which is kind of cool. And then our next scene is Charlie comes home again and once again can't park in his own driveway. Mm-hmm. But this time he's got a little muscle from Shep. So Shep goes and he takes one of these drag racers. He doesn't do anything really too bad. He just moves it a little bit so Charlie can get inside his driveway. The dick neighbors see this and they start freaking out and they're like, hey, Goldilocks, these are $30,000 cars. You have any idea what we're going to do if we find one itty bitty scratch on them? And of course, Hulk, being the alpha, is like, you're going to pound my face, drag me across the road, and feed my remains to a warthog. Is that about right? The best fucking line coming up. This burly dude, covered in grease, looks right into Hulk Hogan's face and says, what are you, nuts? This is the 90s. We're going to sue you. Damage to private property, mental anguish, you'll be hearing from our attorney. I piss myself every time I hear that.
Yeah, because it's totally 90s, too.
Oh, absolutely.
It is the 90s, and yeah, that would be the response you're going to get. I'm going to sue you for all your words.
Exactly. Just seeing these burly dudes covered in grease who do look like in a numbers game, right. They probably could take Shep.
I think that's a joke.
Yeah.
You think they could? Not Shep. Maybe Hulk Hogan.
Yeah, okay. Hulk Hogan, yeah. Not Shep, but Hulk, yeah. My next one is, this is right after this incident, by the way. Mark, who is Charlie's son, is skateboarding down in the middle of the street. Not safe, Mark, first of all. But the dickheads with the Camaro, who are driving extremely fast down a residential neighborhood, I don't know how they get distracted, like, oh, this chick lives over here, bruh, and you just see the mullet turn, and they're looking at a house. But apparently, they're looking at a house for a very, very long time because they have no idea that there's a kid in the middle of the road with a skateboard, so Shep has to grab the kid and save his life. But that's not enough.
This is movie logic, bro. Okay. You know, in most movies, when they're in the car, like, people are, like, looking directly at each other while they're driving. Like, they're not even looking at the road.
Right, exactly.
But they're driving just fine. And movie logic is like, hey, what's that over there? And it's like, oh,
yeah.
I can't. I have no clue what's in front of me.
Yeah, that's pretty much it. So Shep has to go teach these little punks a lesson by committing more felonies. He lifts that car up, and he flips it over, and he's just about to knock out that kid. Thank God, you know, Charlie comes over, cooler heads prevail. But not before Hulk does a great thing. He takes, you know what, you used to do it with Hot Wheels. You put them on the top, and you just spin it.
Him. Yeah.
So that was a great little addition. So in a reward for all of these felonies and possible, you know, crimes against humanity, Shep is rewarded with a chocolate cake.
And what happened with the cat? He says the little girl's cat, too.
Oh, the cat. I completely forgot about the cat. So, of course, Shep is a do-gooder, and he sees this little girl crying on the sidewalk. And I will say, he doesn't approach her the most friendly. He just kind of goes, what?
What?
And she's like, my cat. And he's like, okay. And, of course, Shep being Shep just takes a branch and pulls it down. And she's like, wait, that's not my cat. And he's like, all right, well, F it. And the cat just goes flying. It's just one of those sight gags that was just great. Oh, it's great.
I hate suburban.
Okay, so now it's nighttime. And Shep, he can't relax. He can't sit still. I think he's got, like, restless leg or something. He just has to go out. And you ever notice he's always jogging? He's always kind of running, staying in shape. Just kind of wandering around. And this is where he meets the mime in the middle of the night.
Oh, yeah.
Next to a dumpster. I don't know much about mime business going on right away, but if you are performing in front of a dumpster in the middle of the night, I think it's time to change professions. But, of course, this mime is doing the I'm stuck in a box thing. And Shep, I don't remember the exact wordage he said, but it looks like a D7 force field. Uh-huh. And he literally just, boom, cold cocks this dude right in the chops.
Glad I could help.
Oh, my God.
It's fantastic.
My next note is Shep keeps running because, once again, he can't sit still. This is where I put also in the notes, this is 36 minutes and 12 seconds into the film. So if you haven't been ridiculized yet, there's more to come. So he goes to check on his ship and is recharging. His computer literally mocks him and says, you're stuck here. You can't go anywhere. She might as well say, you're stuck here, you dumbass. And Charlie once again follows Shep. And this time Charlie starts just like peeling pieces off of the ship just to see what he do. And it's time to, where is this? Oh, yeah, this is where Charlie starts finding the armor and becomes, Robo Doc or whatever. He puts on the armor and he tries to save a lady with Shep's armor, not knowing how to use it. I don't even know why he put it on. I think it was because he heard the scream or something like that.
Yeah, he was alerted to like a damsel in distress, so he geared up.
Yeah, something like
he
that.
He wanted to be like Shep. That's the whole thing. We're going to see this arc, right? He's starting as a beta, mm-hmm. and he's slowly moving to, you know, the position where all males should be as supreme alpha.
It's all males should be supreme alpha.
Yeah, anything less.
Yeah, so he tries to stop these two guys who are just kind of shaking a woman. I don't know what their intentions are, but probably...
It's nefarious.
Yeah, nefarious. Oh, good word, nefarious.
I
like that.
Dude.
Like that.
I'm gonna bomb a couple times to try.
No, dude, nefarious is a good word. So he tries, and I love... Do you remember what he said? He's like, put the woman down!
Yeah, I think that was exactly it.
And they don't do it because they don't think he's any kind of a threat. I think they shoot him, and he's like, you can't hurt me, but I can hurt you. Just the worst hero dialogue
he's
ever.
He's a beta with a power trip now. Do you see what's happening? He's
got
overwhelming power, and now he's like, I will use my power against you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like, I can hurt you.
Mm-hmm.
No, you can't. And I think they shoot him, and he's like, I'm impervious to pain, and he falls over. Just like he literally falls back on
like
his back.
Yeah.
And I think it's actually the suit itself, by some fluke, the suit manages to save this woman with Charlie just kind of going along for the ride. And she's like, how can I ever thank you? And I don't know why, but maybe he's in pain, but the way he delivers his lines, like,
goodness is its own reward.
He's and probably he walks away.
I think he's in pain.
I'm that's what I'm assuming. Anything you want to add?
So yeah, so not only right was Shep's privacy invaded here. Mm. Right?
Oh yes,
his
yes.
belongings used and technically stolen without his permission. Right, mm-hmm. But this was a terrible mistake because, of course, the evil space emperor aliens can track the use of this, like, you know, space technology. So
oh, yes.
because it was activated and used, now the bounty hunters know where you're at.
Yep. Here comes Taker and other bounty hunter guy.
Yeah, other bounty hunter guy.
I'll probably, you know what? This is the part in the video where I will put his name right here on the screen. Yeah, so
editor, do that.
Yeah, editor, please. All right, so here comes another one of my favorite scenes, the arcade scene. I don't know how many arcades are open late at night, and I certainly don't know how many arcades are open, you know, with no, it seemed like no supervision whatsoever. That's just the parent in me.
It was the 90s.
It is the 90s, yeah. So Shep just comes upon this random kid who is really, really into his video game. And he's like, I can't beat Dragos and use your phasers. I can't, I'm out of phasers. Then use your photon torpedoes. I can't, he absorbs the power from the photon torpedoes. We get a glimpse of the game. And it is clearly, clearly Afterburner. It's not a space game. It's Afterburner. Anybody who's ever played freaking Afterburner knows it's Afterburner. But Shep is just taking control of this video game. Apparently, he knows what to
Kicks
do.
Kicks the kid out of the way. Yeah,
yeah, he's like, give it up, does, Dragos. Dude. Give it up. And I think he says that like twice, which I think that's really in my mind. He says it twice. He plays this game and conquers it so freaking hard that the game breaks and has a little white flag that sticks out at the end, symbolizing its demise. And of course, we get that stupid joke that everybody sees coming. Wow, you must play this game a lot.
Game? What game?
Oh, boy. Next, we have that poor mime. Because once again, Shep just won't leave this mime alone, man.
You'd think he would have learned his lesson the first time.
I'd stop miming after getting knocked in the chops by a big, burly, blonde, bald dude.
What was he doing this time, though? He wasn't in the box.
No, he was like pulling. No, he wasn't pulling on a rope. Oh, he's climbing a ladder. He was pretending to climb a ladder. So Shep decides, I'll help you out. I'll just throw you. So he throws him up onto like a balcony or something. And even now this time they're like, oh, I should have stayed home tonight. Huh? It's really done cartoony. But why would you mime at night? That's my next note. Why would you mime at night? So,
he's got little mime babies at home, man. He's got to make a living.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so our next one is Shep is, I don't know, he's enjoying his quiet morning. I guess he's sleeping, but there's ambient noise outside. There's like lawnmowers, and there's kids laughing, and there's birds chirping, and apparently Shep can't deal with all of this noise. So he screams, quiet, at the top of his lungs. And, of course, you get silence for comedic value. But what I don't understand is if you want it so quiet, why didn't you go back to bed? Because right after he screams that, he just goes on about his day.
Well, they woke him up.
But, I mean, but if you scream quiet and then everything goes quiet, wouldn't you want to go back to bed?
He's just a dick.
He's just being a dick. Yeah. Oh, so, all right, what else we got? Oh, so he's going to a marketplace where we find a nice elderly woman who's explaining the quality of melons by squeezing them.
This is a fact, too.
Yeah. It is a fact. You can find the good ones by squeezing them. So Shep finds a melon that he feels is pretty good. He wants to test it out, so he squeezes it to the point of it exploding into this woman's face.
I think I found a good one.
Yeah, you did. You did, Shep.
There's so much of him like harming like sweet innocent children and like yeah. old ladies.
Exactly. So we now cut to Charlie going back to work And this time, Shep is going to follow him because he knows that Charlie took something off his ship. He suspects something anyway. He knows that something's not right. So he's going to confront Charlie. So he's going to go where Charlie works. And this is kind of a funny scene between the secretary and Hulk, because Hulk's like, I need to see Charlie Wilcox. And the secretary's like, in a meeting, can't be disturbed, leave a message or take a seat. He literally destroys something on her desk. And she gets up with just as much alpha energy as he has and goes, I said take a seat. And we all know what's coming.
He sits down, dude.
He sits down.
That's right.
That's right. He picks up the bench and looks around like, where am I supposed to go with this, brother? And she's just like, yeah, that's real funny, real funny.
The point was, though, he like acquiesced what she wanted. Like, she did kind of dominate his alpha energy with hers.
That was kind of cool to see him kind of like, oh, okay. So, Hulk needs something. That's my next note, because I cannot understand for the life of me what the hell Hulk Hogan says to Christopher Lloyd when he says, did you take my... Al-Horizer.
It's like when you're writing in cursive and you don't really know how to finish.
It was like Al-Horizer. That's the best I can do. I do not know what the hell he needs, but Hulk needs it back.
Come on, man. You know the thing.
The thing. So they have to find it. They have to find it within the place where Charlie lost it, which is where he saved that woman in his, let's say, RoboDoc suit. So my next note is Hulk rips the door off of the driver's side of Charlie's car, but the other side was unlocked the whole time. So, because Charlie can't get his keys out fast enough, Hulk rips the door off of this Ford Festiva, and Charlie gets in, and Hulk just casually opens the door on the other side, which happens to be unlocked. Yeah, yeah. So now we get another shot of our bounty hunters with, there's no other way to say it, it's the PKE meter from Ghostbusters. They're tracking.
Oh, it absolutely is.
It is the PKE meter.
Absolutely. I noticed that it jumped right out at me. I was like, this is a recycled movie prop.
Dude, they raided Dan Aykroyd's closet and got the PKE meter. I didn't even know how they got licensing for that, because this is... it's a New Line Cinema movie. How did they get the rights to it?
Don't you love it, too? Like, there's no... like, how the heck does this thing work, you know? How does it tell you which way to go? It's just beep, beep, beep.
Yeah.
But hey.
It's just like you hit one button and one of the antennas raised. Oh, go left. Hit the other button. Oh, go right. So my next note is Frozen extras, not so frozen. So this is a scene where those two bad guys that Charlie fought earlier did get a hold of this Al-Horizer thing. And it's pretty much a freeze gun. So they go to the bank and they start freezing people. So we have a bunch of people who are made up to be frozen extras. And God bless them, they're trying really hard. But we can tell y'all are moving, y'all are breathing. Not convincing. Yeah. And I also have Jingle Bells is playing during this scene. So is this considered a Christmas movie?
Please no.
Okay.
I'm going to have a bit of a, yeah.
All right, I will concede.
Just because there's jingle bells in the... Really, Jeremy?
I had to put it out there. Okay, so the dudes are arguing over this device. Right. And what...
because these are the thieves, right? These are the guys that like that Christopher Lloyd beat up.
Yeah, these are the... yeah, they found this thing that fell off his suit after he ran away. So they're arguing over this thing, and they're like, I found it! And the guy's like, well, I figured out how it works. And I'm looking at the design of this thing. It's a gun. It doesn't take much to figure out how this thing works. It's a gun. It's a freeze gun.
No, maybe they had a hard time figuring out guns, and that's why they weren't very successful criminals prior to this.
Maybe. Yes, yes. So they're in the bank. They're getting the money, but here comes Shep. And, of course, they're like, ah, this guy's no problem. Watch this. Jordan, I'm going to let you take this line, because they spray Shep with the freeze gun, and Shep says,
I'm frozen. Oh, no. Of course not.
Antifreeze.
Yeah.
He's guzzling a bottle. Wipes his face.
Antifreeze.
Of course.
Yes.
Antifreeze.
Because this, I mean, really, it explains Shep as the character. Space Commando was fully prepared, absolutely knew it was going to happen,
mm-hmm.
outsmarted the bad guys every step of the way.
Absolutely.
But you know, he brought Christopher Lloyd along with him, and he wasn't as lucky, right?
No, unfortunately, Christopher Lloyd got caught in the crossfire, and now Shep has to carry a Christopher Lloyd doll out of the bank and hold him up through the sunroof while he's driving. Shep knows how to drive, too. That's amazing. Shep knows how to drive. Let's see. What else we got? Oh, we get another glimpse of the bounty hunters. They're starting to track them down, getting a little closer. More jingle bells. And Charlie becomes unthawed, and we get my favorite line of the movie, where Hulk starts, you know, berating Charlie for stealing his stuff, telling him the bounty hunters are here, and it's your fault. And, of course, Charlie's like, my fault? How the hell was I supposed to know that you were some sort of alien Rambo?
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, it's your fault they're here. He's like, oh, Christ, I was frozen today! Which I want to point out is a line that I still use to win arguments, okay? When arguments are getting too intense, I pull that out, I win. So, yeah, that's my favorite line. And Shep is just like, these guys are going to come for you. They're going to come for your family. They're going to destroy the world. 10 minutes of listening to your ice cream trucks, and they'll destroy this place. So we have to stop them. So which bro just got married? So this is the scene, the next scene. The two bounty hunters, for some reason, drive up to a drive-thru. I forgot, Kahlua Burger or something. It's Hawaiian themed, but you got this totally broed out voice going, whoa, check it out. You two just got married. It just happened to be that they're in a stolen car that says just married on it.
Yeah, is that like a dress prior? Like, did you see them steal the car?
I don't
remember that.
Think
like, they're
so.
All of a sudden just in this car.
Yeah, they were just in a car. These guys know how to drive. Apparently, they've been to Earth before. That's what I'm assuming.
It makes sense. Our, you know, our primitive technology, they'd be able to master it quite easily.
Yeah, so the guy's like, whoa, you guys just got married. That's awesome. We got a honeymoon burger. Like, what place offers a honeymoon burger?
It was the '90s, dude.
It was the '90s, yeah. So they shoot the thing, the talk box, and they just keep going on.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see. It turns out that Shep, to charge his ship, needs something called simian crystal. And wouldn't you know it, this just happens to be the substance that Charlie's boss has in his office, and what his awards for however long he's dicked around his employees to get accolades. This is what these are made out of. This happens to be simian crystal. And there's also a party going on tonight. So Shep and Charlie are going to go to the tower to get this simian crystal to get these bounty hunters off their back.
So the crashed party. Party crashers.
Basically, yeah. I say how plot convenient. Margie is thirsty for the Hulkster.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you see the attraction is there right away with Margie. She packs heat. I forgot to bring that up. She has a gun at her disposal pretty much at all times. So that does come up later. My next note is, ooh, crystal heist. Larry is still a dick and wants to kiss Charlie for some reason. He says, I'd kiss you, but I won't. Because Charlie did make some alterations to some plans that he asked him to do. And all the I think they're Chinese clients who are, you know, going to have this done for them. Think it's all Larry, or excuse me, I forgot the boss's name.
Yeah,
but yeah, we're calling Larry Miller. But they think it's all Larry, and Charlie's just like, you know, a grunt. So they have no idea that Charlie's pretty much responsible for everything.
Mm-hmm.
So Margie is still packing heat when Charlie and the Hulkster finally find the simian crystal and try to steal it. Margie stops them for one reason. She doesn't seem to have any kind of real personal interest in it, but she doesn't want her boss's crystals.
She's a good secretary.
Crystals to be stolen. So now we got the bounty hunters finally catch up to Charlie and the Hulkster.
And now it's on.
Yeah. And they activate, before they meet up, they activate Robo Boots, ?
Dude, again, another movie stolen prop. And I don't know time-wise, but those really reminded me of the jump boots in the Mario Brothers movie.
Yes, I agree. I don't remember what year the Mario Brothers movie was now.
Oh,
it was around the same time though. But yeah,
it could have been totally different. But
Robo Boots.
The concept was the same.
Yeah. So my next note isn't even a note. It's just a drawing, and I remember what it is because they take a piece of rebar, to demonstrate how strong they are. Mm-hmm. They bend it, and then the bounty one bounty hunter hands it over to the Undertaker, who unbends it, and then Shep takes it and bends it into the form of a rabbit, which I thought was just cute. My next note is, dude is heavy, and rocket boots away. So this is the scene where activate the rocket boots, and we get, I don't know, did you see that the faces that the Undertaker was making as he was going through the floors?
Uh-huh.
Comedic gold. I really wish I could get a screen cap of that, because he's just like, ah! And you'll never see the Undertaker with that face on him. So it was fun to watch that.
As he's just blasting through floor after floor.
Just floor after floor after floor. Let's see. Bounty Hunter. What did I say here?
Well, thankfully, jump ahead, the Undertaker's the last one to die.
Oh, yeah.
It's actually funny, because technically the Undertaker's character kills the other bounty hunter.
Oh, that's right.
With the elevator.
Because he smushes him. Yeah. That's what it says smushes him. A bounty hunter, I got smushed. My next note is, the Undertaker literally flies up a woman's ass. And that's not a joke. He's going through the pipes, the system of the plumbing. He literally comes up through a toilet that a woman is sitting on. You see it. I mean, not in graphic detail, but you see her legs on the floor as he shoots up. So the Undertaker did fly up a woman's ass. And he meets up with the Hulkster, and this is where we get the only line that the Undertaker has in the film. And for some reason, they gave him a toddler voice.
Yeah.
What does he say again?
You're a dead man, Ramses.
Oh, that's right.
He says, like, no wonder you guys never talk.
I swear, dude, when I was a kid, like, we repeated that back and forth after we watched that movie forever, just those lines. You're a dead man, Ramses. It was genius. Again, it, like, it's silly, stupid, childish, but like it hit really well.
Yeah. Well, this movie was definitely made for those kind of kids in the 90s.
Yeah, you weren't supposed to take it so seriously, to be honest.
Oh, seriously at all.
Yeah.
So my next note is, Hulk looks very uncomfortable in a suit. He just looked like he was just kind of itchy. That's kind of neither here nor there. General Suter gets the fam. So he's not relying on bounty hunters anymore. General Suter has, in fact, landed on Earth and has gotten Charlie's family.
Right. Is this where are they already back at the house?
Yeah.
Because General Suter is supposed to have been dead. Like, he was supposed to have died in the explosion where Shep left the president to die.
And Shep, I think he was on his way out. I think he was getting ready to leave.
Yeah, yeah. So, yeah, because he got the fuel or whatever he needed to fix and or power his ship.
Yeah. So they were basically said their goodbyes, and then General Suter gets the fam, and I wrote reptile? ? Amphibian? ? So Shep, you know, he finds out that Suter has his family, and Suter is one of those kind of overly British actors, and I wrote down, my next note was, you're going to die much more painfully. I remember that line because he's one of those villains, you know, because Shep's like, what are you going to do, bore me to death with speeches, brother? And yeah, no, you're going to die much more painfully. So Charlie finally grows some balls and grabs on to Suter's balls.
Right, with Chef's mechanical glove.
Yes, he's got his RoboDot glove, and he's grabbing onto his balls, which apparently is the Transformer button.
Well, you have to... He ripped him off.
Oh!
Because you heard the hydraulics. I'm pretty sure, right? Like, there's some power there. Like,
you're right. You're right.
That was some serious damage.
Oh, yeah. So, yeah, I guess that would trigger a transformation in me if I had the ability. So General Suter becomes the creature from the Black Lagoon. And, you know, Shep has to fight him off. And
he's, like, unstoppable in this form, too. Like, it's funny. Yeah. Why wouldn't you just stick around in that form?
Yeah, I don't understand why you want to go around in human form pretending to be a weakling when you can totally just dominate everybody. And, honestly, you cast a more intimidating figure as the creature instead of a bald-headed, overacting British dude. But he doesn't exactly die in the best way. He doesn't have the best death scene. He backs up into the Transformer that lights up the whole discotheque, and that's how he dies. And that's also Shep's ship blows up. So Goodbye, General Suter. Everybody else is alive and safe. Shelley Duvall bangs Christopher Lloyd's head on the concrete a couple times after threatening to kill him if he'd ever try anything like this again. I thought that was kind of funny. He literally just got out of an explosion, and she's banging his head on concrete.
Mm-hmm.
Loving wife. Let's see. We get another scene with Charlie going to his boss, Larry, who has been entertaining these Chinese folks all night. And the funny thing is, he's trying to speak Chinese to these people. They know everything he's saying, and they're making fun of him behind his back the entire time. Mm-hmm. So Charlie finally gets the balls to quit. He's done being the workhorse of this dude. He's done. I quit. I'm done. And
right, because the boss is just postponing. Like that's he's kept these Chinese businessmen, right?
You know, yeah.
All night waiting on Charlie.
Yeah.
Because Charlie's the one who knows, who has the pitch. Like, I actually don't even know what kind of business they're doing. Is it like architecture or
I'm
something?
I'm pretty
like
sure
that.
It's like architecture.
So, yeah, Charlie's the one who's done the designs, and he knows what's going on, and the boss really has no clue. But, yeah, he's nonetheless, he was going to take credit for everything. And as we're leading to in the story, Charlie has had an awakening since he's hung out with Hulk for so long. He absorbed some of his alpha energy and became a little more alpha himself.
Exactly. Exactly. So Charlie quits. I put, yes, boy. Next line, 1991 Hogan style. Hogan is wearing, I think it's Chuck Taylor's, a multicolored pattern sweat pant and a bright teal long sleeve t-shirt. And I just read 1991 Hogan style. I'll never forget that. And this is also the scene where he gets a second chance at the skateboard. The kids come up with the skateboard.
And like magic, dude. Now he can board.
Oh, dude, like he's Tony freaking Hawk on steroids. But but yeah, he could do backflips and handstands, and we get the no way.
Way.
That all shit.
Oh, yeah.
But of course, in performing these incredible feats of acrobatic, you know, activity, he breaks the kid's board on accident. So Shep's like,
here, take mine that I suddenly have.
And it's like an overdeveloped board. It's got like fins on it. It's got six wheels, gold and black. It's something that it's not practical for anything at all. So yeah, take mine. And our next scene is Shep is, they're pretty much recapping everything that Shep went through. Kind of so he knows what to do now. So now we get the macat girl again. And he's like, once again, he just approached her. What now? Macat, are you sure? Uh-huh. Pulls down the cat. I forgot what happens after that. He pulls down the cat, and then the girl's like, naughty kitty or something like that.
And it just runs away somewhere else, I'm pretty sure.
It runs away, and like she gets launched into the air, and Shep has to, of course, he doesn't let her fall. He doesn't let her, you know, fly away. He catches her, and she's all right, and everything's good. And he just tells her to get a goldfish. That's the punchline.
Genius. Get a goldfish.
Okay, so now we're getting to the end of the movie. Shep's leaving, and he's finally got some sentiments and some emotion with Charlie, so now he wants to actually say goodbye, give him a handshake, and he's taking Margie with him. Why not, right? Because I'm sure she's prepared for everything that outer space has to offer. So
this is the way the movie should end.
Oh, exactly. So Shep is not going up there alone. And they take off in the bounty hunter ship, which is shaped like a beetle, in broad daylight. No cloaking device or anything. He just takes off. Why not? And the last scene is Charlie finally gets enough balls to shoot the damn signal light. Another felony. But yeah, he shoots the damn signal light and everybody can go. And then we get William Tell's overture and the credits. And that, ladies and gentlemen, was my 3-page comprehensive note on Suburban Commando.
We hope you enjoyed this one because he obviously put a lot of work into that, way more than me. I forgot half of the movie, to be honest, like the details. I was just going to say, like the rest of our reviews, it was a good movie. You should watch it.
Yeah.
Good for the kids, honestly.
I really wanted to make this one comprehensive. So we got a couple more minutes. Let's just address it. It is Christmas time. Happy holidays, everybody.
Merry Christmas.
So let's just do it real quick. You got your top five Christmas movies?
Yeah, I'm trying. I mean, put them in order is kind of hard. I think I kind of gave you a little bit of crap about this one because you tried to mention that the Suburban Commando was like a Christmas movie because of Jingle Bells. And maybe people would disagree. I think Home Alone. You could say both of them, but I think Home Alone 2 is probably the better. I don't know. Oh, it's hard to say.
I love Home Alone 2.
Home Alone is definitely a Christmas movie, and and we watch one of those, if not both of them, probably every Christmas.
That is a Christmas movie.
I'll just put both of those as number one.
Okay.
I don't know. Getting fives is going to be hard because I know I would do like all the Grinches. I like the old animated Grinch song. I definitely like the song, but you know the cartoon that they had. And I would just, again, the Grinches. I know number one is like Tim Allen's Santa Claus. So I just really enjoy. I actually enjoy those. Those are good.
Mm-hmm.
I put the Grinches in there because technically I'm kind of the Grinch of my family. I'm not super into Christmas. What about? So there's my top three.
Okay. You know, just
Grinch. Grinch, Grinch, Grinch.
Grinch, Grinch, Grinch.
And Tim Allen Santa Claus.
All right. Yeah. My kids love the Grinch. I didn't even put the Grinch on here, and I probably should have, but my top five, and these are in order for me. Number five, Batman Returns. We did a very long talk about Batman Returns in our episode 4. It's a great Christmas movie. It's around Christmas. It has Christmas trees in it. Alfred says Merry Christmas to Batman at the end. It is a Christmas movie. Number five, Batman Returns. Number four, and this is a recent one, Krampus. I'm all about horror comedies. And if you can kind of shoehorn a holiday in there, all the more fun for me. Krampus is a fun, and I will say it, a fun family horror movie. I would watch this with my kids. Well, maybe not my youngest, but I will definitely watch it with my older kid. It's funny, it's fun, it's not too gory, it's scary, and it brings to life a legend that I've known for a long time. And the guy who did Krampus also did Trick or Treat, and that's another great holiday-themed movie. So, number four, Krampus. Number three for me, Scrooged with Bill Murray. I absolutely love that movie. It's a great twist on Charles Dickens' classic, and his comedic timing is great, and all of the side characters and everything. That's great. So number two is a little more traditional, Christmas Story. You'll shoot your eye out, kid. There's a reason that this movie is put on a 24-hour marathon on TNT and TBS. Well, I don't know if they do it anymore, but back in the day, they would put this movie on for 24 hours in a marathon around Christmas. I love the story. I love the characters. I love the music, the setting. Everything about it is just Christmas nostalgia for me. And finally, number one, National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation. For obvious reasons. It's a staple of the holidays. It's hilarious. It's heartwarming. And it's a part of the 80s that's just really touches my heart. So those are my top five holiday films.
Awesome.
And, this has been another extended edition of The Rabbit Hole.
Holiday edition.
Holiday extended edition. We probably won't see you guys again until 2024. So once again, you guys have a happy holidays, Merry Christmas, and we'll see you in 2024.
Thanks for joining us.
See ya.